Hello friends, welcome to Investment Banking Tutorials from Wall Street Mojo. My name is Dheeraj Vaidya and I'm the founder of wallstreetmojo.com. And today's tutorial topic is a very important valuation topic, that is the free cash flow to the firm. Now, I have seen students and professionals learn about free cash flows to the firm in a very, very difficult way. What they do is they learn just the formulas and they start applying it in the real life without ever understanding what this is intuitively. So today's tutorial will actually focus with the help of example as to what this is and why you should actually care about free cash flow to the firm or FCFF. Free cash flow to the firm is a very important concept in investment banking and equity research. And as we see, Warren Buffett in 1992 annual report said, the value of any stock, bond or business today is determined by the cash inflows and outflows, discounted at an appropriate interest rates. So he was talking about nothing but the free cash flow to the firm. So let's now get into the intuitive understanding of what this free cash flow to the firm actually means with the help of an example. So here we have an example. Let's assume that there's a guy named Peter and Peter wanted to start his own business. Now, the business requires capital, right? So let's assume in this case that Peter invested his own equity capital to an extent of $500,000. And likewise, he takes a bank loan of another $500,000. So the overall investment in this company is to an extent of $1 million. So let us now look at how Peter's cash flow statement looks like in year zero. So you will find that this is a different kind of a cash flow statement, which you may not have seen earlier. Here, what I have done is, there are three divisions, of course, cash flow from operations, cash flow from investments, and cash flow from financing. But here, we are trying to make the sum total of these two and call this as excess cash. Okay, I'll come to what this means later, but for the time being, just remember that cash flow from operations plus cash flow from investments is the excess cash. And of course, the cash flow from financing, which is basically the external sources of funding, these are divided into two parts, debt and equity. So that's how this whole statement is divided into. So let's go and see how year zero for Peter looks like. So of course, Peter has raised $500,000 in year zero, and $500 he has invested in his own equity capital. So the total funding before even he started his business, he has $1 million of funding. So I'll just complete the other set of formalities here. The net change in cash is nothing but $1 million here. Beginning cash of year zero is of course zero. So net change in cash is $1 million. And the ending cash turns out to be the beginning cash plus the net change in cash, that is equal to the ending cash. So this is how Peter's business looks like in year zero. So now let's move on and look at the further example. So this was year zero. Now here there can be two scenarios that can pan out for Peter's business. Scene one is what we are now going to discuss. Peter's business with not enough earnings. So we'll go step by step and see how it moves. Let's assume that the Peter's business in year one generates a modest $50,000 and the cash flow from investments, of course. When you want to earn money from your business, you have to invest in your business first. Like, say, for example, if you are in a logistics company, you have to invest in offices, trucks, etc. So likewise, Peter has to invest in assets. And let's assume the investment is to an extent of $800,000. So $50,000 is his cash flow from operations that he generates from the main operations. The investments is the cash outflow to an extent of $800,000. So let's find out the excess cash. Excess cash is nothing but the sum total of these two. So that comes out to be $750,000. Let's also assume that there's no debt and equity raised during the period. So the cash flow from financing is nothing but zero. So what's the net change in cash? The net change in cash is this excess cash plus the cash flow from financing, that is minus $750,000. What's the beginning cash for year one? The beginning cash is nothing but the ending cash for year zero, and that is $1 million. And let's complete the remaining formality. So what we get is the ending cash as $250,000. So this was the end of year one for Peter. Okay, let's go to year two. Now this year, we're given that Peter generates $100,000 in year two. And he is also required to regularly invest in assets. Of course, your assets will get depreciated over a period of time. So you have to invest in those in order to maintain those assets at the level, at the operating level. So here in this Peter's business, we are assuming that $600,000 is basically his maintenance capex. So that's what is he invests into. So let's go back and put these numbers here, $100,000 and minus $600,000. So what is the excess cash? The excess cash is basically, it comes out to be $500,000. Now look at these two numbers. $250,000 is the cash that he had, and $500,000 is what he must spend. So of course, there's a deficit in terms of cash here, so he must raise capital, either ways in the form of debt or equity, but he has to make good this deficit so that his business can survive. So let's assume that he goes to the bank and raises another $250,000, so that his business can survive in year two. So this is what the assumption is here, $250,000. The bank is ready to provide a loan to this guy, and equity he invests none. So the total comes out to be $250,000. What is the net change in cash? The net change in cash is nothing but $500,000 plus $250,000. So that is $250,000 with a minus sign. So let's complete the other formalities in terms of cash flow. Ending cash of year two. Year one is equal to the beginning cash of year two. And we have the net change in cash as $250,000, and we get the ending cash as $0. So this is a very tricky situation where Peter is left with no cash and rising debt as of now. Okay, so this is the situation and in the year two. Let's move on and let's see what happens in year three. So of course, let's stress Peter out a bit. I'm sorry for that, but this is just for the case study part of it. Let's assume that his business again generates $100,000, and again he's required to make a maintenance capex of $600,000. So again, as we saw in the earlier year two, he has to make good the external funding to a tune of $500,000 now. So what I mean by this is the same situation that happens in year three, right? Now he is left with no cash as of now. So what's the amount of external funding that is required here so that his business can survive in year three? That is to an extent of this minus $500,000. So let's see how he raises that. So in this case, we have assumed that debt financing round of another $250,000 at a relatively higher interest rates, and Peter invests his own $250,000 as equity capital in order to save the company. So that's what happens here again. $250,000 here, $250,000 here. So $500,000. Let me complete the other set of formalities. So at the end of the day, what we are left with is ending cash as zero. But the business has survived for 3 years, right? So let's go to year four and see what happens next. Now, in this case, Peter's business again generated only $500,000. Maintenance capex expenditure, which is unavoidable, is another $600,000. So a very tricky situation here for Peter. Now, what he does? What should he do? Now, he has and he must rely on this external source of funding to actually keep his business afloat, right? So as we saw in year one, he had to raise debt capital. Year two, he had to raise debt capital. In year three, he had to raise debt as well as equity capital. Now year four, he is in a similar situation. Now what should he do? He has to raise capital anyhow. So in this case, he approaches the bank again, and bank is now ready to give $500,000 at a very, very high rate, which he takes, right? He must ensure that the business survives. So that's what he does. And As you can see, Peter is in a very stressed out situation where his business is not generating enough. He is not left with enough cash at the end of the day. Now, what do you think will happen if this whole situation continues in year 5 too? Now, here as we can see, the bank has given the loan here with a rider that it will come at a very high interest rate. Now, if in year 5, Peter's business perform in a very similar way, what will happen? Now, at the end of the day, the bank will say, no, we can't give you any further loans. So, of course, Peter will look at his own bank statement and probably realize that he doesn't have enough cash too. So, at this stage, maybe Peter will have to really take a call and say that, I'm done. I cannot proceed. So, this company will go bankrupt at the end of the day. So, what we have seen in this case study is that the core cash flow from operations were not enough for the company to help survive the overall tide without the external funding from the debt or the equity capital, right? So if you look at what if Peter business goes bankrupt, the overall flow of liquidation process will be in this format. Peter's business goes for sale, and whatever is the amount that is generated from sale, the debt holders are paid first and then the equity holders. Okay, so let's say the Peter's business is liquidated, and let's say he is able to generate, let's say, $500,000 from this liquidation process. Okay, now what is the total loan amount that he has taken from the bank? The loan amount that he has taken from the bank is nothing but the sum total of this, right? So how much is the total? This total is $1.5 million. The liquidation process has given only $500,000, right? So the bank will take a loss to an extent of $1 million. So that's the loss that the bank will have to take on it on the books. But what about Peter? What about the value, the shareholders' equity value from Peter? Now, since there's none that is left over, the value that Peter gets is nothing but. So, the moral of the story here is that the cash flow from operations were not enough to generate enough excess cash. And hence, the value of Peter's business came out to be zero. Let's look at another case where we will see that Peter's business is actually doing exceptionally well and it may not rely on external sources of funding. So what will be Peter's value in that case? So this is how Peter's business is going to perform in scenario 2. So as we said, in scenario 2, we'll assume that Peter's business is doing relatively well and it's generating cash flow from operations in the increasing order. So year 1, let's say 50,000 was there, 300,000, 650,000 in year 3, $1 million in year 4, and $1.5 million in year 5. So likewise, we know that the cash flow from investments is $800,000 and maintenance capex of $600,000 each for the remaining 4 years. So what we see is the excess cash. Of course, it is the same for year 1 in scenario 2 and scenario 1. But it's kind of different for year 2. We note that there is still excess cash of minus 300,000 here, right? So let's see, you know, how this other part of the table actually pans out, and whether we have to raise fund or we don't have to raise fund, we'll come to know in a moment. So let's assume that here there was none in terms of the financing that was done. Net change in cash will be equal to what we did earlier. Like this. So beginning cash was 1 million. So I'll do it real quick. So this is $250,000. So now we have $250,000. The excess cash is minus $300,000. So of course we are still at a deficit, and the deficit is to an extent of $50,000. So this time, let's say Peter approaches the bank and the bank is willing to give them a bridge loan of $50,000. Equity is not required. So the net change in cash is nothing but the sum total of these two. and the beginning cash is $250,000. The net change in cash is $250,000, and then the ending cash becomes zero. Okay, so far so good in year two. Now let's look at what happens in year three. Now the year three is a different situation where this excess cash starts becoming positive. $650,000 is the cash flow from operations. So since this is positive, do you think this business needs external funding now? Of course, it isn't. Doesn't require any. So net change in cash is how much? Net change in cash is this plus this. So I'll just complete the remaining calculations. So the ending cash is 50,000 here. So let's look at year four. The revenue was the cash flow from operations was 1 million and the investment cash flow was 600,000. So it generates an exceptionally well excess cash. So what we see is the net change in cash is $400,000, and completing the remaining, we see that the ending cash has started increasing now, right? So let me complete the other part of it too. So what we note here is that by the end of fifth year, Peter's business has generated $1.35 billion of cash. Now, if you look at and start comparing what we did in scenario one and what we did in scenario two, of course, now this business is generating enough cash flow from operations, and after deducting it from the cash flow from investments, it's generating enough excess cash that it doesn't rely on the debt and the equity. That is the external funding, right? And any business model that doesn't rely on external funding for a long term will have value, right? Now, do you think Peter's business has value here? Of course it has. It is not going bankrupt, and it should have some kind of value, right? Now, what's the total debt? The total debt is $550,000. So Peter has enough cash which he can use to repay the loan, and he'll still be left with the cash in the system, right? So his shareholders' equity value is more than zero. It's not zero as we saw in scenario one. So that's the moral of the story here, is that when we did the case study one, the revenue was stagnant and not growing. And the excess cash, the negative, well, it was negative. And the trends in excess cash was kind of stagnant. So equity shareholder value was zero or very low. In case study two, the revenue was growing, cash flow from operations was increasing, excess cash was definitely positive, trends in excess cash is increasing. So we saw that there is a shareholder value associated with it. So if you look at what this excess cash is nothing but CFO plus CFI and is growing. Broadly speaking, an intuitive definition is that this excess cash is nothing but the free cash flow to the firm. It is the free cash flow to the firm. It is CFO, cash flow from operations. And when you deduct the cash outflow from investments, what you get is the free cash flow to the firm. A business that generates positive free cash flow to the firm on a going concern basis has some value. Those businesses which don't generate any free cash flow to the firm on a going concern basis has virtually no equity value. So that's the intuitive way to understand the free cash flow to the firm.